not going to be getting as much oxygen as it needs, and so you're going to feel a little lightheaded, a little bit dizzy.
You said there's how much percent less oxygen?
About 20% less.
Because we're at how high?
10,000 feet plus. Let's move over so they can get past.
On to the last telescope up here. This is called which telescope?
This one is the Large Binocular Telescope, LBT.
That's the one you have the posters of.
Yes.
When Galileo used his telescope for the very first time, and he saw mountains and craters on the moon, and a Milky Way with thousands of stars, and he saw Jupiter with four tiny moons. He was the only man on Earth that night who knew that Copernicus was right. Come outside with me.
They look like a festival, like it's a party.
Well, it is. It's actually, this telescope is the most unique telescope and most powerful telescope in the world right now. First of all, it has mirrors that are bigger than any mirrors that they could ever have cast before, and the reason is because of the spin casting technique that Roger Angel at the University of Arizona Mirror Lab developed. So instead of, most mirrors would be solid. So they'd be this solid sheet of glass with this mirror put on top of it. Well, what he said was, well, if we can make it hollow inside, first of all, we can keep it cooler so it doesn't take so long to cool down. And second of all, we've now, it's not near as heavy because we have much less glass. So instead of, these things are about 18 tons instead of 60 tons. So it makes a big difference in the size of the structure you have to do and how big you can make your telescopes. So they can make the telescopes much bigger now because of this. Then you've got the two mirrors, so we've doubled now our light gathering ability because we've doubled the size of the mirrors. And so that makes this one unique. But what really makes this special is not just the size of the mirrors and the way the mirrors were built and the fact that they're like the VAT mirror, they're an f1.6, which means they're less than two times, you know, the length, that their focal length is less than two times the size of the mirrors, so we can use a smaller building, a smaller dome for them. But what really makes this one special is what they call adaptive optics. Telescopes that are reflecting telescopes, the light comes in, it hits the primary mirror, it bounces up to a secondary mirror, and then goes down to the observer or whatever equipment that you have. With this telescope, what's unique about this is the atmosphere moves. We want to be high on the mountain, so we don't have as much atmosphere. They like to observe in the winter because the atmosphere is cold, and so it's still, because when it's warm, it's moving. And that helps them see better. But what makes this one really special is that no matter how cold it is or how high you are, you've still got the atmosphere and it's still moving. So they took the adaptive optics, and so this secondary mirror, instead of just being an ordinary flat mirror, it's an extremely thin mirror with all of these little actuators on it. So when they're looking at something, it's constantly adjusting so that it takes out the effect of the atmosphere, so they get these perfectly clear pictures. So they used to think that the only way they would get good pictures was to put something in outer space, like they did with the Hubble Space Telescope. But with this thing, with its adaptive optics and the fact that its mirrors are so much bigger than they could put in anything in space, they have taken a picture that Hubble took that was really good, that showed a binary system, and resolved it into six separate stars.
Wow.
And so it's amazing. This thing is, there's nothing like it, and until they bring Magellan on down in South America, there's not gonna be anything close to it.
Where are they gonna bring it in South America?
Where is it? I'm not exactly sure what country it is, but they're going to have a total of seven down there, one in the center, six around.
What can you tell us about the shell, from looking at the shell of the building?
Okay, this building, like the submillimeter, the whole building rotates. The doors to the telescope, when they open the top and the whole side, it just slides out. And so that's what some of those supports are for, is to hold the doors when it opens.
Which part slide? You mean where we see the girders?
We're actually on the doors are on the other side. We're not seeing the doors. They have these little doors that are open for ventilation. When they're observing, they have them open all the way over so that they get air going through all the time and keep the ambient temperature down. And so also helps minimize wind load. But when it does open, it opens all from the top. The telescope can point all the way up, all the way down to the horizon. And then, of course, the building rotates 359 degrees, so they can go all the way around either way.
It rotates 359 degrees.
They can't go a complete circle without having to go back.
So this is a papal observatory.
This one is not.
No, the other one. Okay.
That one is.
The first one. That's
this
why you call it the VAT.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That one is VAT stands for Vatican Advanced Technology Telescope. This one is...
And they actually, at the Pontifical Science Academy, which is behind St. Peter's, behind where the Pope lives, is the academy. Very, very high security. No one goes back there unless you're invited. And so, and the original one was made because of Galileo, but they have a direct link to here inside of
fiber optics.
Hard to breathe, right?
I'm trying to remember what I'm supposed to say with no oxygen.
Yeah.
The Pontifical Academy of Sciences, the building there. It's amazing. Well,
join us as we check out what's inside. That'll be on the next video in the series.